You're tuned in to Knights Rewatch, presented by Dex Imaging, a proud sponsor of UCF Athletics. Dex Imaging is the nation's largest independent provider of office technology with a local touch. Dex Imaging, do business better. Also presented in part by Tico People's Gas, delivering natural gas that helps you save energy. Visit peoplesgas.com. And by Pacifico Beer, reminding everyone that if you've made it here, you're already living life anchors up. Discover Pacifico responsibly.
Welcome to the 2018 American Athletic Conference Football Championship. What a scene at UCF as they look to keep their winning streak alive. Memphis, for the second consecutive year, taking on the Knights with the title on the line. Again, everyone, Bob Wischusen here with Brock Ewart. Allison Williams will join us in just a moment. Unless Texas pulls off a miracle comeback over on ABC, this game may not carry the meaning for UCF that you hope. They had an infinitesimal chance of making it to the college football playoff. Having said that, though, it doesn't make what they are continually trying to do that much less amazing.
Yeah, maybe the meaning on the outside polls, and in particular that playoff that they so badly are clamoring for to get in. But today, in these 60 minutes, they won't think about that for an iota. All that they care about is getting their 25th win. All they care about is winning back-to-back championships and really playing for a quarterback that they love so much that can't be on that field with them today.
Obviously, our thoughts are with Mackenzie Milton as well. Mackenzie, we know you are out there watching. We know you're home with your dad. We had hoped to meet you and watch you play football today. And I think we speak, Brock, for our entire crew. We're really looking forward, ultimately, to getting that opportunity someday to watch Mackenzie Milton.
And I firmly believe, Bob, that we will. And there is no question college football is better, Mackenzie, when you're a part of it. But there's also no question in this building that we spent time in yesterday, they're going to play their guts out for you.
UCF won the toss and deferred their option to the second half, so it will be Memphis that will start with the football, and Tony Pollard brings it out to about the 22-yard line. Well, it is the run game that this offense for Memphis is built on, and Darrell Henderson, who racked up 178 yards and a couple of touchdowns last week against Houston and ran for a 199 in the regular season matchup between these two
teams.
And
they do it in a variety of ways. They call themselves a pro style as far as many of their plays and concepts. They do it with a lot of tempo. You will see a mix of Wildcat quarterbacks and plenty of Tigers carrying the ball this afternoon.
And they'll start it with Henderson. And he is thrown down by A.J. Wooten after a gain of a yard.
It's inside, it's outside. Typically, Henderson's a guy they love to get out on the edges where he's most dangerous. But you will see every variation of the run game today.
Play action. Brady White trying to set up the tunnel screen. Pollard makes the catch. He picks up four. It'll be third down and five.
Big early on the road, and Brady White knows it. The transfer from Arizona State started every game this season for Memphis. Got to get this crowd out of it. You do it by moving the chains.
A slant over the middle, easy pitch and catch, first down to DeMonte Coetzee, who is the favorite target of Brady White, picks up 15.
And you'll see that again and again and again. 1,000-yard receiver. They love to isolate him, either with three receivers away from him, try to create one-on-ones. That's too easy, a pitch and catch. Jasinski, the middle linebacker, flying out underneath the little swing route, created that window of opportunity. Tackle there, Roger Joseph, hardest in the noise on those players on the edge. Memphis will mix in tight ends. They will mix in multiple formations, but many times those tackles in this place is filled and it is rocking. Hardest for them to hear.
Henderson breaking tackles. Darrell Henderson down the sideline. What a start for Memphis. Touchdown. 62 yards.
That inside round. Randy Shannon, defensive coordinator, Bob. When I asked him, and I ask these coordinators every week, what's the biggest matchup for you? What'd he say? Without hesitation, he said, my inside guys, my one technique, my three technique, clearly inside that pylon, an explosive play for arguably the most explosive running back in college football. In that matchup that Shannon was concerned about, Memphis takes advantage of.
Did not take long for the Tigers to take the bounce out of the bounce house as they've got a 7-0 lead. They ran for 401 yards last week in their win over Houston to get them to this game. And Henderson already with 63 yards rushing, including the touchdown run. Didn't even take 2 minutes for them to strike first.
Yeah, these are the two techniques, okay? A one technique and a three technique. You will see UCF line up in that all game long. And if those two cannot get off blocks, if they get pushed beyond that line of scrimmage, it is advantage Memphis. You can look at all the perimeter run, and Darryl's got a ton of it. So many runs of 30, 40, 50 plus this season, but it starts inside. These are two of the best offensive lines in this conference. There is no question about it. And you can't do it better than Woodard and Kaiser and Parham, and that group did against Heupel on that opening drive.
You saw the number. Explosive plays, at least on the ground. How about overall explosive plays? That is the 16th play for this Memphis offense this season of 50 yards or better. They were number 3 in America in that category coming into today, and they add to it with a score.
Yeah, I think there's a lot of teams that walk into this building the last 2 years intimidated. Intimidated because of this 24-game win streak, not the guys in blue and white. They have played right down to the wire the last two occasions against these guys.
An intentional short kick and a fair catch just inside the 24-yard line. That's Jake Hescock, the tight end. So, of course, who in college football did not shade their eyes when they saw the highlight of Mackenzie Milton going down with as devastating a knee injury as you will ever see in any sport? That turned over to Darryl Mack the game last week against South Florida, and they would win the war on I-4 going away 38-10. But that means the second career start for this young man comes in the championship game.
And he's got to be who he is, not Mackenzie Milton. And he's very different at 230 pounds, and I expect plenty of QB run from number 8 today.
Jet sweep action, and Mack to throw on first down. And that's a bullet that's incomplete. He threw it behind Gabriel Davis.
Well, that's a real tight window, but you know the idea here for Heupel. He wants to, and Josh Heupel, the head coach play caller, he wants to get his physical quarterback on the move. Both in the run game, out moving the pocket, try to get him reacting and not thinking from the jump.
Quarterback run. And Mack is piled up after a gain of 4.5. Third down and 6. Coming back to help the quarterback is Davis. Reaches the ball out, and it looks like he's got the first down. Quarterback run again. Mack lost the football. A scramble for it, and who's got it? Memphis thinks they have a takeaway inside the 30-yard line. Welcome to the American Championship game. If you're just joining us and just got done watching the Big 12 title game, well, we have an incredible atmosphere here in Orlando as well, and a big momentum swing turnaround to start. J.J. Russell just knocked it away from D.J. Mack, the quarterback. A takeaway for Memphis, and they've got the ball at the UCF 27-yard line after they scored on their opening possession. Bob Wischusen here with Brock Huard, Allison Williams, and Brock. Memphis has done a lot. A takeaway and a long touchdown run to take a lot of the bounce out of the bounce house.
Yeah, but you can hear this place. They know it. They know they're down their quarterback. They know they're down their star. And right now they're down 7 against a Memphis team that will not be intimidated by this environment.
One-on-one slant. And that's a first down to Demonte Coxey inside the 15-yard line. And Brock, here is the score just a moment ago. 62-yard touchdown run for Darrell
Henderson. Second leading rusher in all of college football. The most explosive at his position. Did it yet again. The big fellas, well, they got the movement up front. And you give Henderson a crease, he's gone.
And now Henderson lines up to take the direct snap in the Wildcat. And they'll just run power. And he will power his way inside the five for another touchdown. Darrell Henderson with two scores. And Memphis has put their stamp early on the AAC title game.
Well, the perfect last name for the blocking tight end, that would be Magnifico. When you get two guys and you're pulling around on that play, you get not only a gold star, but you lead your star running back into the end zone. And Josh Heupel is looking at a big, physical Memphis crew that had gained in confidence, had played their playoff the last 4 weeks. They knew they had to win. They had no more margin for error. They bounce all the way back. They win their side of the division. And right now, you have come out and done exactly what you needed to do to quiet this raucous crowd.
Well, you got this. A little bit to the right. You got it. You are so gonna make the team.
Addition Financial can't help you with your jump shot. But for home ownership, affordable financing, and savings accounts, count us in.
Welcome back to the 2018 American Athletic Conference Football Championship Game here on ABC, presented by Jared. Two quick touchdowns from Memphis, and they have the 14-0 lead. A UCF team that has been one of, if not the most resilient in college football. But that resilience has always been led by Mackenzie Milton. They don't have him after a devastating knee injury last week, about as bad as you'll see in any sport. And Mackenzie Milton, it's Bob Wischus and Brock Heward and Allison Williams here at the Bounce House. And we know you are watching at home with your father. And we were really looking forward to watching you play football today. So our thoughts and prayers are with you on your recovery. And we'll see if Mackenzie Milton's team can now answer as that kick goes out of bounds, so it will come out to the 35-yard line.
Free kick out of bounds. Kicking team number 36. Ball be placed at the 35-yard line. Comes down.
And let's go down to Allison.
Bob, Darrell Mack with the difficult task of stepping in for injured quarterback Mackenzie Milton, made even more difficult with his team trailing here early, but it's also very emotional. These two guys are really close on and off the field. When Mack left the game last week against USF, he held up Mackenzie's number 10 jersey. He also tweeted out a picture of Mackenzie FaceTiming into the quarterback room, where apparently he added a bit to the game plan and had a few pieces of advice for Mack. So it's an emotional start for him, and Milton's presence certainly missed.
Well, after the fumble, here is Mack. And he picks up a first down, a quarterback run for 11 yards. So we'll see how Brock Mack responds after he coughed it up, and that leads to the 14-0 lead.
Going to have to play to his strengths, and that is running the ball. That's already his third carry this afternoon. We've seen inside zone read, that time just a QB sweep. You see it all day.
Swing pass to Greg McCray. He stays on his feet. Greg McCray brought down by Josh Perry, but he picks up 17 more.
And you will see this kind of tempo. You're not going to slow down. It's absolutely who you are. And Josh Heupel told us yesterday, not much in the plan changes with Mack, who knows the system inside and out.
McCray again to the 35-yard line for two. Curtis Akins, who left the UConn game in the third quarter earlier this season because there was a baby beeper that alerted him that his son was about to be born. And the defensive coordinator, Chris Ball, heard, "You better get to the hospital." Stepping up and breaking a tackle is Mack. Dives for a first down.
Yeah, he's a big kid. I want to get down on that field pregame. And you know, he can't be built any differently than Mackenzie. Mackenzie about 5'10", 170 pounds. Darrell is every bit of 6'3", and you see that lower body strength, carries well over 235 pounds. Arm tackles will not bring him down.
Mack, low throw. Is it scooped up? It looks like they are going to say yes. It is a catch for 9 yards to Dredrick Snelson. McCray First down.
Pretty good response. You said it before the kickoff. You're down 14. You have about the worst start you can, a turnover that leads to seven. And you can hear the boos in this stadium.
That's because O'Brien Goodson is down. And the crowd here at UCF, there's always a cynical belief that this is an injury designed to slow them down. But O'Brien Goodson looks legitimately hurt, so we'll step aside.
There he is, good, strong Herbie.
In Hawaii, Ohana means family, and of course, Mackenzie Milton's number 10 has been merged into this hashtag. 40,000 leis handed out to the fans, all in a show of support for the recovery of Mackenzie Milton. His family did release a statement about the surgery that has restored blood to the area of his leg that was impacted. He's had three surgeries and then will require in about 4 to 6 weeks a reconstructive surgery to try and put his knee back together again. And his team trying to respond, down by two touchdowns here in the AAC title game. Bob Wischusen, Brock Ewart, and Allison Williams here in Orlando. Greg McCray finds a lane and finds the end zone. Touchdown.
Well, I talked about Magnifico, the tight end on the other side. Colbiali, the tight end right there, 86, gets the key block and the patience and the resolve of these teams. And I think you're seeing here very quickly in this conference, they can play at the line of scrimmage. Two best offensive lines in this conference. Well, they're making it known here in the first 6 minutes of play.
So without Mackenzie Milton, UCF is down by a touchdown, but his mom did come to the game today, and a short time ago before kickoff, she spoke with our own Allison Williams.
Here now with Teresa Milton, Mackenzie's mom. And Teresa, I can't even imagine what the last week has been like for you and your family. First of all, how is Mackenzie?
Mackenzie's doing great. Excellent. I mean, his attitude, his miracles, he's doing great. We brought him home last night. He can move his toes, so his nerves look good. Our trainers are the best in the country. I mean, they knew what was up. The surgery was a success, the best trauma unit, they said, in the country. So he has everything in his favor.
Physically on the road to recovery, emotionally, how tough is it for him not to be here today?
He really tried to get here. He got doctor approval at the hospital, but when we landed here, the trainers were like, absolutely not. And then now I realize he's so tired. It was the right thing.
He did have a message for his teammates. What did he want them to know?
I heard the message, and I think he told them, I believe in you, get this done, let's make it happen. And then whatever they say at the end, like, team.
You're wearing a lei today along with 40,000 other fans. What has it meant to you and your family to see this outpouring of support for Mackenzie?
When I saw the lei blessing, I'm not missing that. I'm coming. My husband said, I'm going to stay with him. So I keep checking on Mark to see, make sure you're being a good nurse, honey. I'm watching you. Or I'm on TV. I guess I'm not watching you. But anyway, I had to see it. I wanted to be part of it. And this lei right here, a Christmas lei, you see the trees?
Yep.
So that was from the Cure Bowl. So the Cure Bowl was a rough game for Mackenzie, but that's what's going to get him through this hurdle, same hurdle there. You know, he was a new quarterback, and so things are in his favor.
Well, Ohana, thank you so much for the time, and we wish you and Mackenzie all the best.
All right, Merry Christmas to you.
Merry Christmas.
Well, our Christmas wish right back to Mackenzie Milton is as speedy a recovery as is possible from a knee injury that was described as career-threatening by more than one doctor when they commented on it this week.
Before the snap, late game, offense, 5-yard penalty, first down.
And some confusion there for Memphis as they lined up Tony Pollard in the Wildcat. Just couldn't get the ball.
No, and that's some of the challenge when you don't have your normal quarterback that's looking at that play clock in every one of those helmets with that Ohana on it. And I'll tell you, Kirk and Chris were here a few weeks ago for the primetime game, and I know it was juiced. It's just as juiced this afternoon. Wow, this stadium's electric.
Pollard again out of the Wildcat. Muscles his way across the 25 out to the 27-yard line. Gets back the penalty yardage plus four more. Kyle Gibson makes the stop. So it will be second down at about six.
Yeah, there's some grown men up front here. 50-plus starts for their center, Drew Kaiser. Travion Tate's the best left tackle I've seen in college football this season.
That's saying something.
Well, he's just unbelievably athletic. These guys have played together all season long, and I love the statement Mike Norville's making. Not afraid to just run it right at UCF.
Brady White wants to set up the screen, finds Henderson. And he is hit hard after a gain of a couple. Met by Rashard Causey, third down and close to five.
We've been in some cool environments this year, Miami, Florida State, Nebraska. Listen to this crowd on third down as these guys are flying. You're going to see ear pads flying. You're going to see mouthpieces flying. These two teams playing for the fourth time in 2 years know each other, and they know what's on the line.
On third down and a long four, Patrick Taylor lines up in the Wildcat. He gets outside. Blockers out in front for Taylor. No one's going to catch him. Out of the Wildcat on third down to the house for Patrick Taylor. 70 yards.
Magnifico. Once again, our tight end and that left tackle, Bob, that I was pointing out again and again and again yesterday as we were watching tape. Travion Tate, he got the big block. He's one-on-one with Titus Davis, the best defender for UCF. If you want that edge run to be good, you better be so stout on the edge of that offensive line. Travion was. Magnifico kicks it out. It doesn't just have to be Darryl Henderson getting in the explosive fun. The multifaceted aspects of this run game. Tough to defend.
A two-touchdown lead again for the Tigers.
At Blaze Pizza, artisanal quality at crazy fast speed is what we're all about. Fresh dough made from scratch daily. Choose any toppings you like. Then it's just 180 seconds in our blazing hot oven for fast-fired perfection. Enjoy your Blaze favorites for delivery or carryout. Right now, we're offering delivery specials through our app or online, including a one-topping large pizza for just $10 or two-topping large pizzas for $22. Download the Blaze Pizza app or visit us online at blazepizza.com.
It will come out to the 25-yard line for UCF. And now how will they respond down by two touchdowns again without Mackenzie Milton?
I haven't looked at this much this year. This UCF defense with Randy Shannon has been dominant. There have been seven opponents that have not scored 20 points an entire game. Seven of the 11 contests, they've given up 20 or less. They've given up three touchdowns here in the first 7 minutes of action. A little bit more here on Darryl Mack's plate. And I'll say the same thing. You've got to be you. Four runs already, four pretty conservative passes. Play to your strengths.
Play action on first down from a clean pocket. He takes a shot for Jacob Harris, and it's incomplete. Harris had a step on T.J. Carter.
Yeah, and you will see this from UCF. You're going to see hitches and slants, and you'll see shots. Not a real intricate intermediate game of comebacks and in cuts. Well, a lot of teams in college football aren't, and especially with their tempo. Short passing game shots and a mix of that QB run game.
Mack coming back to help out the quarterback, Trey Nixon. He's got a first down. Scoots around T.J. Carter.
I think you're getting a little feel here for why Josh Heupel was pretty composed with us yesterday. Pretty confident in this entire supporting cast. Yes, McKenzie has been the magician, and he's been the wizard and the maestro that makes it all go. But a lot of good offensive linemen, four good backs and receivers on the perimeter as well.
Climbing the ladder is Gabriel Davis. Just shy, it looks like, of a first down. Although it looks like they may say without measurement, at least head linesman on the near side said it is a first down. They're going to move the chains, Allison.
Bob, everyone we talked to said how just like Mackenzie Milton, Darryl Mack is calm, he's confident, he exudes this positivity. You could see it before the game, guys. He was loose, he was dancing, laughing, joking around with teammates. He seems very much the right disposition you would want for such a big stage with so much on the line. It doesn't seem to have rattled him at all.
Well, he fumbled to lead to the second of these three Memphis touchdowns. Let's see how he continues to handle that. As here it's a draw play to McCray. And McCray lost his footing and picked up four.
And I'll tell you what else is he's been looking at for the majority of this first quarter is a lot of one-on-one situations on the perimeter.
And there are the parents of DJ Mack, Darriel and Hope, that are here to watch their son try and win a title today. And it'll be third down and four after McCray picks up two, tripped up by Tim Hart. This rushes four on third down. The ball stripped out. It's loose. It is another fumble by DJ Mack, and it looks like another Tigers takeaway. O'Brien Goodson got through and put the pressure on Mack.
And remember, it was Goodson that went down on the previous drive. Goodson finds a way to get back in the fold, and you can see a little bit of Mack's frustration right there. This is some of the challenge when you've not played a ton of football. You see the nose tackle get in. He gets his hand on it before that hand of Max is moving forward. Clearly a fumble. And for a UCF team, plus 16 coming into this game, actually hit him on the elbow that forced that ball to pop out. Three fumbles the entire season through 11 games. Already two critical errors here in the first frame.
So now it's back on the Knights defense. A short field. And a two-touchdown lead for Memphis. Zone read. Brady White gets to the edge and cruises for a first down and a little extra right on the sideline by Bam Moore, the corner. And this might cost UCF 15 more.
And that's a frustration play, I think, from Brandon. And this defense that had been playing excellent ball over the last month of this season is not used to getting gashed, is not used to some of these breakdowns and assignments.
There is no foul for a late hit out of bounds. Runner is still gaining yardage. Three first down.
That was awfully close there, and typically get the benefit of the doubt if you are the quarterback. But I like the explanation. As long as that QB is trying to gain extra yardage, you will give that defender some more leeway and opportunity.
And back to the Wildcat for Henderson.
It's been power run game out of this look.
Henderson down the sideline again. Flag down. He's into the end zone with a possible touchdown, but a flag thrown back at about the 15-yard line. And this will go against Memphis.
Holding offense number 10. 10-yard penalty, first down.
That's the wide receiver, Demonte Coxey.
Yeah, and that's down the field. In these wide receivers for both teams, you will see throughout the afternoon incredible effort. And I like that look there, the left tackle Tate. They love the effort, but when that receiver is running by you, you've got to let go. And clearly, you can see it right there. He is tangled up. Hands are outside the frame. That's an excellent call by the back judge. It is looking right down the line. You love the effort and energy. Just keep your hands inside the frame.
So it actually nets no yardage. It's still first and 10 as that call down the field matched up with where the sticks were. Out to the sideline, catch made by Patrick Taylor, about 8 yards.
Mike Norvell said something that stuck with me. I wrote on my little board here yesterday when he said to us that win over Houston last week was the most rewarding of his career. And he's won some big games. In fact, he's won more games in 3 years than any other Memphis head coach. But I know why he said it. Because that opponent knew what was coming and you couldn't stop it. 19 runs in the fourth quarter against Houston. And that same mindset, it's on full display here in the first 15 minutes in Orlando.
Patrick Taylor out of the Wildcat. This time brought down at the 30-yard line. Very close to a first down. It looks like it should be enough. Joey Connors made the stop.
And UCF in the first matchup felt like, remember, they were down. They were down big in Memphis through that rain. Josh Heupel telling us yesterday about the only game he felt like this crew, Joey Connors and crew, they were outcompeted. More effort from the other side. To me, this is more talent up front.
Taylor, that's a tackle for loss. Caught behind the line by Tristan Hill, who was second team all AAC last season. 4 yard loss.
Now, this is the first time you've seen that penetration. You could see there the right guard, Dustin Woodard, is trying to block down on those interior people. And for the first time, you see some mass, some movement. The guys in the black jerseys on the other side dictating at the line of scrimmage.
So Brady White behind the sticks for the first time. Arizona State transfer that was recruited to Arizona State when Mike Norvell was the offensive coordinator there.
Box count check here.
They're going to run it with Taylor. He's into the secondary. Driven back at the 22-yard line. It'll be third down and about three. And a little extra after the play was over.
Pretty easy little box count there. UCF's going to keep two safeties back. You are daring Brady White to continue to check to that run game, and that's exactly what they do. And a little extracurricular activity in the title game. Big left tackle Travion Tate getting a freebie and not getting called for it.
Now a timeout called by Memphis. So a big third down when we come back to the American Championship game.
Guess what I just did? I got a night pass.
Night pass?
Yeah, ePass is now offering night fans UCF branded toll stickers. See for yourself. My windshield now sports night black and gold.
They'll certainly see you coming. But does night pass work on all toll roads in Florida?
Yes, it's accepted on all toll roads in Florida, Georgia, and North Carolina.
Go night pass.
It's how nights travel.
Score big and save more with night pass. Go to getnightpass.com. Getnightpass.com. Hey, night fans. What's on your windshield?
Championship weekend often defined at the line of scrimmage and the point of attack. 183 rush yards by Memphis. Look at them handling the 1-3 techniques right inside. UCF felt like that was the matchup they had to have, and they're not winning it. And because of it, no penetration you're seeing the Polars. Magnifico, the tight end, on multiple occasions like this one, out in front of his playmakers. And it's not just Henderson. It's Taylor. It's Pollard. It's even Brady White getting involved, nearly 200 rushing yards in this first quarter of play.
Patrick Taylor lines up to take the Wildcat direct snap again. Why is UCF playing two deep safeties on third down and short when you're lined up in Wildcat? Numbers advantage.
Yep.
And that's a first down. Why are you taking two safeties and playing them in like a cover two look 12 to 15 yards off the line of scrimmage when the ball is going to be snapped to a player that has little to no chance of throwing the ball?
That has to be a check. And as long as you're going to do that to Mike Norvell, he's going to continue. They told us last night you'd see more Wildcat. You can see the OC Kenny Dillingham as well. More Wildcat than you have seen all year long.
That time only a gain of a yard for Taylor.
Now they do get those safeties, Bob, in their pre and post snap looks. They do get those safeties involved. These are two experienced players, especially Gibson, 27 Grant, first team all conference. These two guys will be in the back end of that trying to disguise a two safety, a single safety look. And right now, once again, content to try to eliminate the big play down the field while getting gashed up front.
That's a false start. Just out of rhythm with the snap, the right side of the offensive line.
False start. Offense, number 66. 5 yard penalty, second down.
Yeah, and that's the second occasion here for Roger Joseph, the right tackle. Offensive line coaches, I know, were watching that check and saying, you're really burning the big boys up front. This is a loud environment. It's most difficult on them. As well as they're firing off the ball, don't make them think and stay in that stance too long.
Quarterback read. And not much there for Brady White. So here's a chance for a red zone stop defensively for UCF. They have forced third down and long just inside their 20-yard line.
And this has been DeMonte Coxey territory. 7 touchdown catches. The tight end Magnifico as well. Down the middle of the field, those have really been the two guys White has looked to consistently this season.
Coxey is at the bottom of your screen when we go wide. Number 10. This is the 10th play of the drive.
And be alert for this tight end down the middle as well.
White out of the pocket. Throws it away. So the Knights get a stop. It'll be a field goal try for Memphis.
That was really good defense. I don't think pass defense will be the issue for UCF today. And that is why this matchup is such a good one and such a dangerous one for the Knights with that 24-game win streak, because Memphis is built to run. And you've seen that thus far.
Riley Patterson looking for some redemption today. Missed a couple of field goals last season, including a 51-yarder that would have avoided overtime and helped Memphis win this title game. He adds 3 here, and it is a 17-point lead for the Tigers. Adrian Killens from the goal line. Tripped up at the 20 and falls out to the 22. We will have the 14th annual Dr. Pepper ACC Championship game tonight. It is Pitt and number 2 Clemson. 8 Eastern on ABC and the ESPN app, so you can watch anywhere. What formula, if any, is there for Pitt to stay in that game and put a scare into the Tigers?
Well, exactly what these Tigers are doing today, and that is run the football, and Pitt is able to do it. And I love the conversation on game day this morning, and they're right. I mean, Pitt stylistically, the interview there Fowler had with Dabo, they play the game. It's either they get knocked out or they're going to knock you out. There's no in-between. There's no playing it safe for Pat Narduzzi, and they're going to try to come out. You know it as enormous underdogs in attack.
Adrian Killens finds a lane, breaks a tackle, and has a first down. Spins for 13.
Boy, these backs are so patient and so quick. The smallest in college football at about 180 pounds, but all of them run so big.
Pick play that frees up Gabriel Davis, and a flag is thrown.
Holding. Offense from the 5. 10-yard penalty. First down.
Did I mention that was a pick play?
I think you saw that one well, Bob. 14 weeks into this thing, you got good eyes.
Oh, that's really not necessary.
It's pretty easy. And once again, it's a hands outside the frame. It's not offensive pass interference because that ball's caught at the line of scrimmage. But much like Coxey on the other side, you get your hands outside the frame, you're going to draw the penalty.
Frederick Snelson snuck a lay under the uniform in support of Mackenzie Milton. And now Adrian Killens, he needs a little more support at the point of attack as Emmanuel Cooper brings him down for a loss of a couple. Jim Blackwood is our referee here in the booth. And not that we're the fun police, but is that a uniform violation that the officials may ask Snelson to remove that leg?
That is a uniform violation. But I doubt if they'll remove it, they'll just forget about it. They got to concentrate on tackling and other stuff.
Off play action, Mack fires a strike. Right at the first down marker, bullet his way for a first down is Gabriel Davis.
Yeah, one of the challenges Memphis has defensively is guys get lost in zone coverage too often. And that time Austin Hall found himself turned around, and a big completion for UCF.
And boy, do they go quick. 3 more yards for Killens before the Memphis front could even get their cleats in the ground.
That was a little bit of action.
237 yards of offense for Memphis, including 191 on the ground in the first quarter. Darrell Henderson with a couple of touchdown runs. Turnovers played a big part in this 24-7 lead for the Tigers as well.
At Wendy's, we got you with open drive-thrus and delivery. So get a biggie bag loaded with a bacon double stack and all this for just $5. It's a big deal at a small price. Drive through Wendy's or get one delivered today.
Welcome back to the American Athletic Conference Football Championship game here on ABC, presented by Jared, all part of Dr. Pepper Championship Week. Bob Wischusen, Brock Ewart, Allison Williams set for the start of the second quarter, and we had a lot of action in the first quarter. A three-possession lead for Memphis, as they have already run for close to 200 yards, and they've taken the ball away from DJ Mack. Mackenzie Milton's replacement twice. Jet sweep for Otis Anderson. And he's to the 45-yard line, a yard shy of a first down. Time for our Aflac Game Fact. Aflac! The only team to make the college football playoff with a strength of schedule rank higher than 50th, UW in 2016. Of course, well below a schedule strength of 50 or better is this UCF team, as we've got a flag down on the third down dive.
Personal foul. Legal use of hands to the face. Defense, number one. That 15-yard penalty to be added to the end of the run. Automatic first down.
No, Brian Goodson's been busy today. Knocked out of the game early to a cascade of boos. Hits the elbow of Mack on one of those fumbles, and that time the hands get up into the headgear, I believe, on the center, Jordan Johnson, there to draw the 15-yard penalty. You can see those two safeties again. That is what Heupel is looking at. That box count checks.
Anderson dives for about 4 yards. And Brock, the committee, leaving UCF at 8. Said about as much as anyone here, I think, in Orlando could take, and certainly sent the message loud and clear. After Michigan was destroyed last week by Ohio State, and they still found themselves in the 7 hole in the standings above UCF. So that tells you, as Anderson picks up a couple of yards, the uphill climb that the Group of Five team, no matter how good they are, is always going to have against those household Power Five names to get up into the legitimate playoff conversation.
Yep, and I don't think there's any question about it, and there's no way in the world, if I'm in that committee room, I would have made that same choice.
Third down and 4. Swing pass to McCray, pulls it down, has a first down. And he's down to the 9-yard line. So where would you have put UCF?
Yeah,
if you were in that committee
room? I mean, they're undefeated. They've won 24 games in a row, and I know it is about this season. They have been resilient. They're incredibly tough. They're getting gashed today defensively in ways they have not all season long. But to me, they should have sat on the number 7 line.
McCray, just outside the 5-yard line. He's brought down by Austin Hall.
But they're just going to have to keep on proving it. And they're going to have to today. After giving up 200 rushing yards, a backup quarterback that's fumbled a couple different times, they are, you know, much like they've been throughout, you know, up against it. And they've got to do more, improve more than anybody in the Power Five.
Well, that time McCray was up against it, so now it's third down and goal. And they will continue to run into what you hear in college basketball all the time as well. No one wants to play us. No one wants to come here and play us. And you're forced sometimes to get Power Five opponents to schedule home and homes, if you're lucky, that are projected 5-6 years out. It's very hard to schedule if you're UCF. 12th play of the drive, third and goal.
Where's your one-on-one you like here?
Play clock down to 5. Mack, he's going to try it himself. Up the middle, lost the football at the goal line. Loose in the end zone. Who's going to get it? It's recovered for a UCF touchdown. The tight end, Michael Kalubiali, is able to help bail out Mack after his third fumble here in the first half.
Yeah, the one-on-one happened to be with Sanchez Blake, the safety right there. An incredible hit, third time the ball's on the ground. But extra effort by the guys in black as they pursue and are very fortunate to find 7 the hard way.
Ruling on the field is a touchdown. They have gone to review. And I'm not sure if there's a chance that Wyatt Miller the left tackle, who was also going after the football. Was he touching the football when that foot went out of bounds before Kolubiali found it? It looks like he may have just barely lost contact with the football before his foot touched out of bounds, which would be a big break for UCF, because that would keep the ball alive for Kolubiali to recover it for the touchdown.
Wow.
Pretty quick review.
After review, the ruling on the field is confirmed. It is a touchdown.
And I don't think anybody in this building knew how close that was. It was clearly a fumble. It was clearly recovered by the tight end. But that big left tackle, Wyatt Miller, very, very fortunate to not have that foot out of bounds and touching the football.
The good news for UCF, it's a touchdown. The bad news, DJ Mack, the quarterback, is in the injury tent being looked at after that hit at the 2-yard line.
Memphis 24, UCF 14.
Pacifico was brewed for those who follow their own path. That's living life anchors up.
DJ Mack has already fumbled three times, the latest of which recovered by Michael Kolubiali for a touchdown. But this hit from Sanchez Blake on his throwing wrist knocked the ball out and put him in the injury tent. He's back out of the injury tent. He looks okay. But Brock, without Mackenzie Milton, you have a true freshman in Quadri Jones. That's all that's left behind DJ Mack. Can you afford to continue to run him as often and as aggressively as they have?
Well, you framed that a lot better than I did to Josh Heupel yesterday, because I asked him that exact question and he stared at me point blank and said, that's who he is. This is championship weekend, is it not? Everything not on the line. We're going to exhaust it and give our big quarterback, who feels most comfortable running the football, the opportunity to do it. But he better start protecting the ball and protecting himself too.
Tony Pollard brings it out and doesn't even reach the 20-yard line. Week 13, Monday Night Football. Washington takes on Carson Wentz and the Eagles. 8:15 Eastern on ESPN, ESPN Deportes, and available on the ESPN app so you can watch anywhere. Our coverage begins with Monday Night Countdown at 6 as the Eagles avoided disaster as they were down by a couple of scores to the Giants, came back and found a way to win. And the Redskins now done in terms of their quarterback. They've got to count on Colt McCoy with Alex Smith going down. Henderson, flag down. Nate Evans, first team all AAC at linebacker, stepped up to make the stop.
Holding, holding. Offense from the 56.
Bob, UCF's defense has given up 24 points here, but coaches pleased with how they responded with the sudden change following the UCF fumble that Memphis recovered, holding them to just a field goal. They have had some communication issues, though. Defensive line coach Shane Burnham telling his guys, every play, you've got to get your eyes on me and be yelling out the call. He also told them that the stunts are getting home, so just keep working.
Well, they just got a tackle for loss and declined the penalty, so they took the down to make it second down and a long 11, close to 12, but they can't stop Henderson. Darryl Henderson looking for another long touchdown run. Will they catch him? They will not. 82 yards. Unbelievable.
I'll tell you what, when you got the best left tackle in college football that I have seen this year, he is creating enormous lanes here for Memphis. Look at my big left tackle. Look at Travion Tate here. He kicks out, and you just see, well, the kind of hole that is such danger right there for UCF. I mean, that is just too easy. Not getting up blocks. Everything Allison just talked about, that their defensive line coaches to be aggressive on those line stunts, to get home, to get your hands off of those Memphis offensive linemen. Advantage Tigers.
The third touchdown run here in the first half for Memphis of at least 62 yards. And they've got a 31-14 lead.
want to thank everyone that has been, you know, sending their thoughts and prayers to me in this recovery process. It means the world to me. I just want to wish you guys a Merry Christmas, and where I'm from, we say Mele Kiliki Maka. God bless all you guys.
Well, you saw the 40,000 leis that were handed out to all of the fans that came into Spectrum Stadium today in support of the recovery of Mackenzie Milton. And boy, could UCF use him now, down by 17 in this championship game early in the second quarter. Of course, Milton not being here has nothing to do with the fact that their defense can't get a tackle against the Memphis run game at the American Championship game just outside of downtown Orlando. Adrian Killens heading south instead of north. Nowhere to go. Tried to turn the corner, and Curtis Akins, among others, were waiting for him. It's a 7-yard loss. Jonathan Wilson helped on the stop from Memphis as well.
It's what you have to do against these backs. As you see Killens coming up a little bit lame there on his lower leg as well. It takes every single one of them in pursuit. Same should be said on the other side. But the other side is getting so dominated at the point of attack, that being UCF's defense, that if you're going to contain this group offensively, you better run and you better pursue for 60 minutes.
Mack well protected. Incomplete. Looking for a flag is Marlon Williams. No flag comes out. It'll be third and 17.
And they want it on Tito Windham, but this ball is thrown so far behind. Is there a little bit of contact? Yes. But I don't like rewarding horrible passes. So there was going to be no chance that receiver could go back and catch that ball. The fans see the replay. They don't like some of that contact. That ball's got to be thrown much, much earlier.
Memphis takes its second timeout of the half.
So Memphis calls a timeout defensively, and we'll step aside as well.
This isn't just a beer. It's a lager. A medium-bodied, amber-colored, one-of-a-kind beer. Made from those bold enough to brew it, for those bold enough to drink it. Tap into your inner eagle. Yingling Traditional Lager. Spread your wings.
Mack back to throw. Going deep down the sideline for Trey Nixon. He's out of bounds. Well, not much more than you have an opportunity to do on third down and 17 than take a shot. And good coverage from Tito Windham.
Yeah, that first down negative run, that is something that a inexperienced redshirt freshman quarterback cannot have today. Not with this deficit. They've done a nice job on their last two touchdown drives, staying on schedule, getting into their rhythm and tempo. Negative plays will doom this offense today.
The first punt of the day for either team. And Mack Loudermilk will try and change field position. Bounces just inside the 40-yard line down to about the 36.
Bob, a lot of frustration mounting for the UCF defense. Guys are getting pretty hot with the way they're playing. And Willie Martinez, the secondary coach, assembled the entire defense, had them stand and gather around him. And he had some pretty impassioned words for them, but also said in part, you guys got to relax. There's a lot of time left in this game. And after the coaches dispersed, it was the players who really got on each other. Randy Shannon talked about how there's so much accountability within this defense. Well, linebacker Nate Evans said to his guys, we got to play for each other. No more of the dumb stuff. We got to wrap guys up and do our jobs. There was a lot of emotion for this defense.
Well, they've given up 272 yards on the ground. And Patrick Taylor looking for more here. And muscles his way for three.
Well, clearly what you are seeing, and you will hear this all the time from defensive coaches. In fact, the best guy going in football, Bill Belichick, those are his words, do your job. And they're really simple to say, but it gets really difficult to do when you're getting run on because you try to do your teammate's job. And, you know, guys are getting pushed up front. Well, I've got to get into their gap. I've got to compensate for them. You start doing that, you start running yourself into real problems.
Now Patrick Taylor out of the Wildcat. That time UCF only had one deep safety.
Yep.
On second down and long. And they forced third down and four. Nate Evans made the stop.
Yeah.
Empty backfield for Brady White on third down. On the slant, broken up. Well defended by Neville Clark, first team all AAC corner. Knocked it away.
And I like
it's a three and out.
And I like this. They didn't call it the other way. Contact was a little early from Tito. That's a little bit early. You saw it last night in the Utah-Washington game as well. Neville Clark is going for the football. Does he go through the receiver just a little bit? Does he knock him off slightly off his route? It's championship weekend. You've got to be able to play through some of that contact. I like those no calls on both sides.
Dredrick Snelson back deep to receive the kick of Adam Williams. Fair catch at the 5-yard line. So it's the long field for UCF, down by 17.
How about Adam Williams right there to Loudermilk on the other sidelines? He's using his tricks.
I don't know if I have time for trash talking
punters
between the punters. Maybe it's just me. That's a little too much. Punter celebration, whatever. Bob Wischus and Brock Ewer and Allison Williams here at the American Championship game. The effect that Mackenzie Milton's injury somehow has on an entire team,
yeah,
and even this defense, to give up these types of rushing numbers, do you attribute it all to the air coming out of the UCF balloon losing their leader?
No, I really don't. I attribute this to a Memphis team that has just been so much more physical at the line of scrimmage. Now, I will clearly attribute the three balls on the ground. Unfortunately for Darryl Mack, two of them recovered by Memphis. You know, that's obvious. As Darryl is thrust into a spot where he has watched one of the best in all of college football win 24 games. Actually 23 as Darryl won the one at ECU.
Greg McCray, flag down as he is out to the 11-yard line.
Offense number 78, half the distance to the goal, second down.
That's a big left tackle there. Wyatt Miller making his 46th start. And this has been a little bit consistent today when you see the hands outside the framework. And that is what that umpire is looking at. And those shoulder pads go up in the air. Again, you can do that at the chest play. You can get away with that inside. It's now the fourth penalty hold we've seen on both sides. And once they get outside that framework, you're going to get that called. And Mike Norville says, no, thank you. I'm going to decline that penalty and force Darryl in the shadow of his own end zone here into a third down.
Well, they did pick up a few yards, though. It's only third down and 5. That's an odd penalty to decline, as they would have gone back half the distance, would have been inside the 5-yard line and made it second down and long. Instead, third and manageable with the decline penalty. Play clock down to 1, down to 0, and it looks like a timeout will be called by UCF to avoid a delay. Big third down for the Knights midway through the second quarter when we come back.
For young people, education can be a guiding light through any circumstance, providing a path to achieve their dreams. The Florida Lottery proudly supports the Bright Futures Scholarship Program, which recognizes excellence in students. It helps them shine so that they can have brighter tomorrows.
Deep in their own end. Mack off play action. Incomplete. Intended for Gabriel Davis. Flag out. And a late call at that. TJ Carter was there in coverage.
I think that might have been a tug on those shoulder pads that did not allow Davis to go catch it. We have seen contact allowed. This may have been the first time we're seeing some contact impeding Davis's opportunity to go catch it.
I don't know if we've got two officials that have a different opinion of what they just saw.
Pass interference, defense number 2.
Well, the official that threw the flag won the argument because they enforced the penalty.
And is that little tug right there with his right hand. Does he have a little bit of a tug right there? Is there a little bit of a pull that's impeding Davis's opportunity to go catch it? They've let him play, but I believe that that tug impeded his opportunity to go get it.
That's a huge call for UCF. They were punting from inside their own 10-yard line without that call. Back again, off play action, looking for that same route. Incomplete for Davis.
Boy, he likes to stay in stationary, doesn't he? So, something we looked at yesterday, it's amazing. Look at him in the pocket here. Look at, he is just frozen. Right? I mean, he is just standing as flat-footed as you can. I'm never a fan of that. My dad, QB coach, used to say, be like a boxer. You want to be light on your feet, right? Everything you do athletically, very few things are you just standing so statuesque like that.
This time a little bounce, and he'll take a shot for Snelson. Drops it in.
There you go.
Dredrick Snelson got loose. Josh Perry brings him down, but not before Snelson picked up 54.
Now what a great move at full speed. He runs a little quick post-corner post from that slot position, and he never slows down as he turned the safety around.
McCray, quick snap on first down. Moves the pile inside the 25-yard line of Memphis.
Stop on number 97 for the Tigers, a mark of the 24, second down.
A little bit of bounce, right? And a whole lot better throw there, and another explosive. Two teams that put a bunch on the board.
Blitz off the edge. McCray runs away from it and picks up another 2.5. So it's another big third down. Bryce Huff made the tackle for Memphis. McCray splits out on third down. At the 20-yard line, he is brought down. Now it's fourth down and 2. A field goal here makes this a two-possession game again. But UCF is leaving their offense on the field to go for it and playing with tempo on fourth and 2. Timeout called by Memphis from their sideline before the snap. We'll come back with fourth and 2 in a moment.
At Wendy's, we got you with open drive-thrus and delivery. So get a biggie bag loaded with a bacon double stack and all this for just $5. It's a big deal at a small price. Drive through Wendy's or get one delivered today.
Bob Schuster and Brock Ewart, Allison Williams. Josh Heupel is going to put his faith, Brock, in this offensive line on fourth down and 2.
Three first-teamers and a second-teamer. About 150 starts combined between them. That is the statement you're making right here. I trust these guys to create enough movement and the ability, you know, 2 yards to run it inside and outside.
And it looks like they're going to line up Greg McCray to the right of Mack in the backfield. McCray up the middle. Nowhere to go. Shut down at the line by Memphis. A turnover on downs for the Tigers. It looked like Austin Hall stayed home and made the stop.
Well, there were 9 guys within that line of scrimmage, and they're just unblocked defenders. I mean, you're going to see the read and reaction there. Hall with a tremendous play on third down on the little bubble screen. And that time he reads, reacts, as does the linebackers at the second level, and there was nowhere. It was a hat on a hat by the 5, but it was a much better trigger in anticipation from that second level.
When you see a defense lined up with 8 guys in the phone booth, so to speak,
yep.
Where does quarterback check to something on the perimeter
no
come
question.
To play there?
Yeah, probably if McKenzie Milton was playing quarterback, I don't think that's the call.
Well, here's Darrell Henderson playing quarterback, and he's off again. Shoved out of bounds after a gain of 8 by Joey Connors.
Now that was a high risk, high reward opportunity on fourth down. You could have kicked the field goal, made it 2 possession, and now you're further burdening this defense that just simply has not had an answer. And give Austin and crew on that side of the ball credit for an enormous fourth down. And if Memphis continues to just step on that gas, and I think this would be, I love this commitment to continue to run right at them.
Henderson, first down and more, finds another crease. Finally brought down near midfield by Richie Grant. 21 more for Darrell Henderson. What a first half he's having.
Well, and look at it. Look at the hat on a hat. Look at everybody. It's like Velcro. I mean, he's not being touched. His first contact is 17 yards down the field. Now, part of that is absolutely his patience and vision. But this is thorough domination at the line of scrimmage right now.
Now it's Tony Pollard's turn. He's off to the races. Carrying tacklers down close to the UCF 35-yard line. 16 more for Memphis.
And Mike Norvell said last week was the most rewarding win that he has had at Memphis in a game they needed. It was 31-31 on a fourth down call they had at the end of the third quarter where he went for it and ultimately got it and ran it 19 straight times. His team has continued to take on that action and that momentum and move it forward.
Pollard wrestled down behind the line. Enough, said Tristan Hill.
Well, he's the one. He's got the two tackles for loss today. That's it. He's been the only one, a second-team all-conference performer a year ago, has had to take a back seat this year to Wooten and Connors. And he is the only one that has been able to shed blocks here in the first half and stem that tide at the line of scrimmage that has been so dominated by a really physical Memphis crew.
Brady White, screen, blown up. Patrick Taylor, nowhere to go. Richie Grant read that one, a loss of 7.
Yeah, Richie says, thankfully, that wasn't about someone getting a 15-yard head start on me. That was a read and react showing why he, too, was a first-team All-American Conference performer.
Third down and 19. And on third and 19, they're just going to run straight ahead with Patrick Taylor out of the Wildcat again. Another tackle for Tristan Hill.
Yeah. Number 9 said enough is enough.
That's a lot of faith to have in the Wildcat to just run it straight ahead on third and 19.
Here comes your punter celebration, Bob. Get your popcorn ready.
We'll see. Adam Williams will kick it deep to Otis Anderson. Play clock down to 5. As Memphis is trying to get set. They're out of timeouts. But they get the snap off. And there is the end over end kick. Anderson fields it on a fair catch at the 6-yard line.
First and 10 UCF.
Well, excuse me. I think that's retribution for trying to show up Loudermilk.
Oh, I think so. Who knew? Who knew the punter's gonna have so much fun?
I don't see many other teammates over there participating in the kicker celebration. Coming up on the Capital One Halftime Report, we'll check in with Kevin Agande, Jim Mora, and Jonathan Vilma. A recap of a really good Big 12 championship game, and they'll take a look at tonight's ACC title game as well. This is the American Championship Game. Bob Wischusen, Brock Ewart, Allison Williams from the end zone, Mack to throw. Looking for Davis. Got it to midfield. Gabriel Davis has a step, and UCF back in business. He beat Tito Windham.
How good was that throw?
Flag down, back at the line of scrimmage.
There is no foul for chop block on the play.
They pick the flag up for a would-be chop block that gives UCF the explosion play to midfield.
Yeah, I'm a little surprised because this usually gets called, and you can see Mike Norvell right there. That anytime this is close, you are going to protect, and you can see the center was engaged, and the running back came in and hit below the legs. It is right here, right in the middle.
There goes Craig McCray. gets it back at the 10. First and goal, UCF. Two snaps, and they're from deep in their own end to inside the Memphis 5-yard line. 47 yards on that carry from McCray. First and goal, and like lightning, they're ready to go again. Here's McCray, brought down behind the line. And that quiets the crowd as Bryce Huff makes a tackle for loss close to the 5-yard line.
Yeah, this is, I think, this drive showing you the resilient nature of this program, of this team, and why this is going to be a 60-minute game period. No matter what it's going to look like, you just do not win for 2+ years straight, 24 consecutive games. You get stuffed on fourth down. Yeah, you're at your own goal line, but you can eat up 90 yards in a mere seconds.
Mack, a pop pass, back of the end zone. Caught, touchdown. Jake Hescock held on. And UCF is able to make this a 2-possession game again. The lead is back down to 10. Lead here in the second quarter. 10-point lead now for Memphis. The question now becomes, can UCF defensively shut down the run game in any way, shape, or form and get stops? And that is Josh McMullen, a backup tackle, who wears 46 to give UCF an opportunity to go with their jumbo package. And there's the coach. He wants the crowd in this game. Josh Heupel egging on Spectrum Stadium, and they are responding. It's a 10-point lead for Memphis, but the crowd is becoming a factor with 2:41 to go before halftime. Pollard from the 5. Blown up at the 21-yard line.
So, Jim, help me understand why this is not a chop block, if you wouldn't mind, on that previous play, because it was discussed by the officials, and you're going to see the center right here is engaged. Running back comes in. How is that not a chop block? I typically see that call, Jim.
By rule, that is a chop block because he does go low. He catches him at the thigh or below. Had he caught him at the waist, it would not be a chop block.
He's below the waist. The center reaches his hands out.
That is a chop block.
It's got to be called.
That's Jim Blackwood, our referee expert here in the booth. First down pitch and catch to Patrick Taylor. Nate Evans pushed him out. Memphis is out of timeouts, but they've got plenty of time on the clock to score again before halftime.
And they will get the ball to begin the second
half. Taylor about 3 yards short of a first down.
Stand corrected. It was actually UCF that deferred. So they will get the ball, which makes this an awfully, awfully big third down if you're Memphis right now.
UCF still with two timeouts. Dropped pass. And that will stop the clock with 1:55 to go in the first half.
Yeah, I think
they got a timeout call before the snap.
UCF took its second timeout of the half. The 30-second timeout on the third down.
What a break for Memphis as DeMonte Coxey dropped what would have been a failed third down attempt. The Knights would have gotten the ball back, but they waived the playoff. It's so loud in here, you couldn't hear the timeout granted to UCF before the snap.
Yeah, I'm gonna guess the student body has no idea that there's going to be a third down here. They are having the time of their lives. It was so fun to see game day come here a couple weeks ago. And in talking to the folks around this program, the American Conference, to have that opportunity to put this gem of a stadium, this gem of a program, on full national display for everybody. And it rocks in here.
Added a few seconds back to the clock. So now 2 minutes to go in the half. Another third down try here as you wipe away that drop by Coxey. UCF still with one timeout remaining. Flag thrown. Tackle made short of the line to gain. Pollard made the catch. Rashard Causey made the stop. We'll have to check the penalty marker. It's against Memphis. Not much debate here, I would think. You decline the penalty as the tackle was made short of the line to gain.
Offense number 53. The penalty's declined.
So now UCF will get the ball again before halftime.
Yeah, big number nine here, Tristan Hill, has made his presence known, and you're going to see a two-point takedown here, about as good as it gets. And that's an obvious holding call there. You saw Tristan do it in the run game, and that time the right guard Woodard, all he can do is grab, tug, and take down Hill. A little better energy defensively out of UCF here the last couple possessions.
Now UCF just spent their final timeout before fourth down and one, in a spot where I can't imagine they would be worried that Memphis would take a chance with a 10-point lead. Is this guarding against a fake? Why else would you spend your final timeout knowing you might need it with a minute and 50 to go before halftime for your offense? Well, tomorrow we'll have the exclusive reveal of college football playoff semifinal matchups. Who will be in the Capital One Orange Bowl and the Goodyear Cotton Bowl Classic? Be played on Saturday, December 29th. We'll find out. Reese and the guys will also unveil all the other big bowl games and have the final top 25 rankings in a four-hour special. It starts at noon Eastern on ESPN and the ESPN app.
Well, you want that four-hour special to be chaotic? You wanted, if you want chaos, you wanted Alabama losing. And right now they're down 21-7, 4 minutes to go to half in the SEC title game in Atlanta.
Fair catch for Anderson. Lost the football! And it looks like Memphis will recover. It can't get more deflating to the home crowd for UCF than another giveaway as Otis Anderson just dropped a fair catch. And does that light up the Memphis sideline?
Bob, this is a UCF team that had three fumbles the entire season. Three. That is now four fumbles in the first half, three recovered. Yeah, and in a punter affair. Mr. Anderson obviously very excited about what he's getting done on his side. Mr. Williams.
So now Memphis has a chance with plenty of time on the clock. Wow. Henderson Inside the 30, inside the 25, eight more. Down to the 23-yard line, stopped by Kyle Gibson. 203 yards rushing in the first half for Darrell Henderson.
And they're going to stick with that Wildcat, and why not?
Henderson looking to add to what is already an AAC rushing record. Came into today with 1,699 yards, and he's got a first down as he's put over 200 more yards onto that record.
Yeah, and it, again, it is just that movement at the line of scrimmage with no Tristan Hill there. He is the only one that's been able to shed those blocks to disrupt that action in the backfield at all. You love the patience and burst, slow to and explode through this entire first half.
Pollard driven back at the line of scrimmage.
Well, now you got to have a little bit of urgency here with no timeouts.
And both teams are out of timeouts.
Yeah, I don't think you just feel like you need to settle for three here. Not against this group, not in this building. And where is Coxey? He is your one-on-one weapon.
Top of the screen, widest to the far side right. That's the way White looks. Slips it down the sideline to Taylor. And he's out of bounds. Inside the 5-yard line.
And what a terrific job by Coxey. When you are the go-to guy, you're going to get the attention. And that time, he does an excellent job of just getting in the way of the linebacker Evans. He doesn't touch him. He doesn't pick him. He's clearly out of bounds right there. But he does a perfect job in the timing of that route to free up his buddy.
How are you going through clock management here if you're Memphis? 25 seconds, no timeouts. Probably time for a running play.
No question.
If you want to go that route and still get lined back up. And it looks like they will line up Pollard and Henderson in the backfield again. It will be Henderson. He wants to throw it into the end zone for the touchdown. Sean Dykes, the tight end, the recipient of the touchdown pass from Darrell Henderson, who has done it all now here in the first half.
And this has been a game of inches on a number of different plays today. And Joey Magnifico, who's been Magnifico blocking, nearly knocked that pass down. He did not know. You'll see the two tight ends out in the flat. He didn't know if it was going to him or his buddy behind him. And good thing he let that ball whiz by him. Mr. Henderson, if you've not known him this season, if he's been off your radar, he shouldn't be. The number two rusher in all of college football coming into this game today. Showing you everything he's capable of.
Finalist for the Doak Walker Award. And he keeps making plays like that. He might find his way onto the United's Golden Arm Watch list, too.
And how enormous have these three fumbles been? My goodness, 17 points off those takeaways. UCF plus 16. This crowd here has not seen it at all. Just 9 giveaways the entire season for Josh Heupel's team. And today, Memphis just plus 2 coming in. We spent a lot of time talking to Chris Ball about it last night. And you give these kind of weapons extra opportunity after extra opportunity after extra opportunity, they're going to make you pay.
Number 2 in America in the giveaway-takeaway ratio coming into today was UCF. And they've given it away 3 times here in the first half. And it has burned them badly. The UCF defense, October 13th at Memphis, had this same struggle. And they rallied at halftime. No opponent has scored more than 7 third quarter points against UCF this season.
They are going to have to find an answer for that Wildcat, because right now they are being mauled at the line of scrimmage with it, and there just simply are not enough numbers to contain all the weaponry.
Well, the Knights are a third quarter team. They have outscored their opponents in the third quarter 108-30.
Yep.
Hard to believe they're going to get too risky with their play calling here.
Yep. And Josh Heupel, he assembled a veteran staff. Randy Shannon, Willie Martinez, we saw him earlier. They will get to work in these 20 minutes to make sure they can put a scheme. There will be an adjustment. There will be a new front. There will be more numbers. You will see adjustments made by UCF in the second half.
Greg McCray with a flag thrown well behind the play. Got out across the 40-yard line. We'll have to check the marker.
Holding offense number 75. It's a 10-yard penalty. First down.
Here's a number that's just a shocker. There is not a team in FBS that has allowed more rushing yards and a half
not even
in any game.
Hold on. UConn?
Than UCF today. Unnecessary swipe at the Huskies by Brock as McCray takes off again. And that will stop the clock with 9 seconds to go in the half, at least for the moment. And they're going to spike the ball and get one more snap in before halftime.
That was not a shot. That was just fact that UConn gave up a lot of yards this year, like over 600 a game, as we learned last night in our production meeting. And UCF has not given up anything like this season. Yes, Memphis had a very nice first half against them, but they, man, it just feels like an onslaught of so many different weapons, and more than anything, a wildcat that you knew the Tigers would use. UCF didn't have an answer.
Mack throws one to no man's land as the clock goes down to 2 seconds. And they are going to say that there was a receiver in the area avoiding intentional grounding. Gray will pad the stats before halftime, and that will take us to the break of this American Championship game. 17-point lead at halftime for Memphis.
When we say charge on, we commit to do extraordinary things, to put in the work, to be smarter and stronger. We're coming. Charge on.
Charge on.
You're watching Knights Rewatch, presented by Dex Imaging. Do business better. Now back to UCF football.
Bob Wischus and Brock Ewart, Allison Williams just about set for the start of the second half. And the question is, can UCF stop that guy? Because the numbers that Memphis put up running the football in the first half were historic. They dominated the first half in a way that no team in FBS this year in a half has dominated with the run game and at the line of scrimmage.
Against anybody, against bad defenses, let alone a UCF defense that hadn't given up 20 or more points to 7 of their 11. They've shut down 7 of their 11 opponents this year, scored 20 or less against them.
For a game.
For the entire game. And that was a first half dominated by Memphis. How about 12.9 yards per carry? It's not very often that we got to pull the calculator out to try to figure out in the first half of action, but 12.9 yards per carry as a team. That Wildcat was dominant throughout. Randy Shannon, his defensive staff, had a lot of work to do at halftime to make some adjustments.
Technique? Is this just a test of manhood at the line of scrimmage in the second half for UCF?
Yes and yes, because in this first matchup, it was adjustments, it was penetration, it was stunts, it was getting into the backfield that slowed things down up in Memphis. And there's going to have to be some scheme, there's going to have to be technique, and then it's going to have to be relentless energy from everybody defensively.
Well, we'll see what kind of field position UCF ends up with to start off the second half. It should be pretty good field position, if not for the flag that has been thrown. Dontavius Thompson weaved his way out to the 38-yard line, but there's a marker down.
During the return, holding receiving team number 6, 10-yard penalty, first down.
So that will back up UCF as we take a look at our Pacific Life game summary and the domination at the line of scrimmage, particularly by Darrell Henderson with the run game, the story in the first half.
Yeah, in the Wildcat, it's certainly been featured this season for Memphis. And last night in sitting down with them, it was very clear they were going to use it and use an awful lot, and they will continue to do so. But this has, I think, been the biggest surprise. UCF so good. Number 2 in America, plus 16 in the turnover ratio, minus 3, 3 fumbles critical in that first half.
And the quarterback run goes nowhere as DJ Mack lost a yard.
Bob, Josh Heupel said they gave up all those runs on the ground because their guys weren't in gaps. Linebacker alignment was off, and that led to them getting gashed for some pretty big runs. They also have to start taking care of the football on offense, as you guys mentioned. And I asked him, you know, where do you find that spark, that magic that Mackenzie Milton so often brought this team? He said, oh, it's inside that locker room. You saw our guys in the second quarter. They will continue to compete.
Well, they'll need it here. That's a gain of two for Taj McGowan. So right out of the locker room, they'll be looking for a spark on third down and nine.
And right out of the locker room, you could see Austin Hall for Memphis, and that time Goodson inside. Those two winning, defeating their blocks and putting UCF now in a third and eight.
Might be a free play. It looked like Memphis jumped off. Mack fires a strike to the sticks. Trey Nixon, he's got the first down.
Offside. Defense from a 55. Penalties declined. The result of the play is a first down.
Josh Heupel talking to Allison about those linebackers and that technique and just trying to do too much. This is Jasinski here, and he is underneath these blocks. You've got to stay on top. Help your buddies out, not run under blocks. Too much of that for Pat and the entire crew on that second level in the first half.
Long throw to the sideline for Gabriel Davis, and a dangerous throw from Mack.
And that was one occasion of going underneath. This time, again, trying to do other people's jobs. You've got to be patient, whether it is the Wildcat, whether it is some of that zone read action, and then the eraser on the back end and end of it, your all-conference safety Grant too many times, not able to eliminate the big play.
Snelson, first down.
And on the other side, this is the start you want for your quarterback. I mean, these are two occasions here, just one-on-one coverage against Memphis. They are going to commit. They will continue. Look at the number of bodies around the line of scrimmage. They will continue to put this game, throwing the football in Mack's hands.
Snelson turns the corner and runs into a brick wall. Lost the football. And McCray looking to jump on top of it. And it looks like he did. Curtis Akins and Josh Perry combined to knock the ball out. Nearly another giveaway for UCF.
I think you heard the official say down by contact, the right knee, I think, here. If Snelson goes down, does it go down before the ball comes out? I think it does.
Well, McCray covered. So because there was a recovery by Greg McCray, and now a flag thrown before the snap, it'll be a false start on UCF.
False start. Offense, number 78. 5-yard penalty, second down.
You know, either way, though, and that's Miller again, unfortunately, with a false start. Either way, that's now five times the ball has been on the ground. And if you're Josh Heupel, right, I know that was the conversation at halftime. It was three fumbles, all of them, you know, a little bit different. Mack, two of them in the pocket. A very sure-handed punt returner, and that just cannot happen on championship weekend.
Mack well protected down the sideline. He drops it into Otis Anderson for a touchdown. Anderson's third receiving touchdown of the season. Josh Heupel told us Otis Anderson has been their best dual threat guy, and maybe the best dual threat guy he's ever been around.
Well, this was a high-risk throw down the field. You could see the safety, Josh Perry, right there. And these safeties have had a hard night on both sides of it with some of their angles. You know, you play that center field spot just like a center fielder. Right, the good ones get such great jumps on the ball. They take tremendous angles. That time, Josh Perry thought he had six. He undercut it. He took a bit of a bad angle. That's an empty feeling as it sails over your head. And well, Otis does exactly what Josh Heupel told Allison. This team will respond, and they will. And you don't need one halftime speech to prove that. You've got 24 games of equity over the last 2 years in battling back, in facing adversity. And I think, without debate, the most resilient team in college football the last 2 years.
How resilient will their defense now be? Now that you're on the sideline, you come out and see the offense get a big play touchdown to open the third quarter. been a long game already for DJ Mack. He has paid the price often, but that time he delivers a touchdown strike. And this one goes past Tony Pollard for a touchback. Will their defense respond? Henderson up the middle, 2 yards. That time, Richie Grant was there selling out to stop the run.
Yeah, there was no disguise there, was there? There was no safety at 8 yards. There was safety at 3 yards from the line of scrimmage.
Kyle Gibson is the only deep safety back at the 40-yard line on this play for UCF. 7 players up near the box. Brady White up the sideline to Henderson. Very close to a first down, and Henderson is hurt. He's slow to get up. They'll mark him down 2 yards shy of a first down, so it's 3rd down and 2. Direct snap to Patrick Taylor. He's got the first down with a flag thrown in the offensive backfield.
Holding offense number 54. It's a 9-10-2, 3rd down.
That's the senior Drew Kaiser, one of 10 offensive linemen to start 40 straight games in college football.
Yeah, and you can see the effort right there in the middle by Connors. Connors, Hill, those inside guys got an earful. I guarantee you at halftime that they had to play with much more relentless push and energy. And that penetration draws the critical holding call.
4-man rush on 3rd down. The pocket starts to collapse. Brady White, he's going to try and run for it. Flag thrown in the secondary as Joey Connors made the stop. And Pat Jasinski is limping off the field.
I think this might be a hold against the linebacker, Nate Evans.
Critical call as White was brought down well short of the sticks.
There is no foul for holding on the play. There's a running play. It'll be 4th down.
So the flag picked up.
Yeah, and take a look at this, Bob. It's the middle. It's the linebacker here that is going to make contact. He is definitely going to hold. But when he holds, quarterback in the pocket still. Ooh.
One coach happy, another coach furious. Mike Norvell can't believe they picked the flag.
And I think he should be again.
Returnable kick for Anderson, driven back inside his 15-yard line. Looking for running room. Still on his feet. Anderson down the sideline, all the way to the 45-yard line of Memphis. What a start to the 3rd quarter for UCF.
UCF, our Knights. Since 1970, UCF student athletes have represented Orlando with pride. Today, Masson Sandwiches honors them with a Knight Sandwich. Your choice of roast beef, turkey, or chicken with sautéed peppers, onions, and melted Swiss cheese. 3 delicious combinations, 1 awesome sandwich. And for every Knight Sandwich sold, Masson Sandwiches will donate $1 to UCF Athletics. Come to the taste. Come to Masson. Famous sandwiches, anytime breakfast, serious coffee.
Memphis head coach Mike Norvell being explained to about why the flag for the holding call that would have given Memphis a 1st down was picked up. He's not buying the explanation. Bob Beschus and Brock Ewart, Allison Williams here, and Brock, hard to argue with why he's so upset.
Oh, yeah. I mean, this is right here. This is as obvious as it gets. That's a takedown. He impedes his route. He can't run his route. I mean, I have no idea why this is now a couple occasions. They've had conversations and picked up those penalties.
Best starting field position for UCF. Mack tripped up behind the line.
I like conversation. You know that. I love when those guys get together. What did your eyes see? I think it's a championship weekend. There's an incredible amount on the line. But when that first flag comes out, it came out for a reason. And you saw that hold, and I am really surprised they picked that one up.
McCray, a former walk-on who was put on scholarship this season, grinds out 7 yards. Big third down coming up for UCF.
Yeah, it was a big third down right here. A big third down that is just can't, to me, be any more clear.
Quarterback draw. Mack moves the chains.
But you know what? If you're Memphis and you're Mike Norvell, you know it. You know you're going to be up against adversity out on the road. Some calls are going to go your way, others aren't, and you have to flush that, much like you had an adverse season this year. Right? And you had to win 4 in a row, and that has to now be the messaging. Nothing you can do about that call now.
Knock out of the pocket. Gets walloped at about the 29-yard line. Gets inside the 30 to the 29. Picks up 5. Joseph Dorsius was there to make the stop.
Much like this kid's done with 2 fumbles. You're going to wallow in your mistakes. You're going to worry about what's done in the past. You got to forget it and press on to what is ahead in a very long game with a ton of plays. And all you got to do is look at the recent history between these two over the last 2 games. It is going to come down to the resiliency and the perseverance of these squads, veteran championship built squads, in the final 15 minutes.
Taj McGowan, very close to a first down. And without measurement, the officials say, move the chains again for UCF.
And look at that movement at the point of attack. Look at those guys. Look at the tight splits and look at the movement created by this O-line in the second half.
Mack looking for the slant. Flag out. Josh Perry bumped down Anderson.
Pass interference. Defense number 4. Ball be placed in the spot of the foul. Automatic. First down.
There's no debate about this one. Josh had the touchdown sail over his head as he took a flat angle. And that time, just a little slant route and a two-handed shove right in your screen right there. Obvious. Quite a punch counter punch all night long between these two.
Off play action again. Slant, this time it's there. Gabriel Davis inside the 5-yard line. It's first and goal. They'll mark him down right at the 5.
And there is so much commitment as Davis is hobbling with that ankle too. So much commitment, so many Tigers around the line of scrimmage. These are just simple one-on-ones. And if you're Chris Ball defensively, I mean, this has got to be the plan. If you're going to lose tonight, you're going to lose with the arm of Mack. Right now he's beating him.
Greg McCray inside the 5. Down just inside the 4-yard line. It'll be second down and goal. Khalil Johnson made the Memphis tackle.
And you could see a group that runs the ball so doggone well with so many weapons, including their quarterback, and Milton with 9 rushing touchdowns himself this year. That's how you get to those very elite numbers. Anything above 75% is winning football. 80% helps you be undefeated.
Quarterback run for Mack. DJ Mack walks into the end zone with a Knights touchdown. 14 to start the third quarter for UCF. You expect anything less from these two teams?
At Wendy's, we got you with open drive-thrus and delivery. So get a biggie bag loaded with a bacon double stack and all this for just $5. It's a big deal at a small price. Drive through Wendy's or get one delivered today.
14 to start off the third quarter for UCF. Here comes Tony Pollard, wrapped up as he gets close to the 20-yard line. Now for Memphis, there has to be a feeling on their sideline of A, guys, we are still in the lead.
Yep.
And B, we have owned the line of scrimmage for the most part this game. But where does this dominance in the third quarter come from for UCF?
Well, you see it. You see the energy. You see the adjustments. A group that came out and executed offensively, got the stop they needed. And you're playing against the best in college football in these 15 minutes right here. This is what you ask for on championship weekend.
And the Tigers lining up to go back to their bread and butter. And that's Darryl Henderson to take the direct snap. They didn't get the playoff. They did not get the playoff. It'll be a delay of game to start off the drive.
Before the ball is snapped, delay of game. Offense, 5-yard penalty, first down.
And Mike Norvell wanted the play clock adjusted. He was not going to get it. And again, those are the challenges. You love Wildcat, and the benefits far outweigh some of the risks sometimes. But a running back toward quarterback that's not always aware of that play clock and trying to have the sense of urgency you need in this building.
Henderson lost his footing, looking for a cutback lane. Second down and 15.
Just look at the force right at the line of scrimmage. I showed you shot after shot we did in that first half of Velcro. Of that line of scrimmage being reasserted 2, 3, 5 yards down the field. Not so much here to begin the second half of play.
Third down and 15. Rashard Causey tripped up Henderson.
And Tristan Hill was 3 yards in the backfield. Engine number 9 down here in Orlando is making his presence known.
Milton jersey providing inspiration on the UCF sideline. An injury to the right tackle Roger Joseph.
And we'll rise up. I like the waves. We'll rise up. In spite of the ache, we'll rise up. And we'll do it 1,000 times again.
Time to honor those who served, brought to you by Navy Federal Credit Union, as we highlight Brandon Lawson, UCF Director of Player Personnel, a former Marine Corps Sergeant. He served 6 years, in part working as a helicopter crew chief to protect President Bush while aboard Marine One. He came to UCF in December, and while he never played football, he said it's a lot like the Marines because it's not about the hours you put in, it's about working until you get the job done, about everyone coming together for a common mission. Brandon, we thank you for your service.
UCF's defense has gotten the job done. Although they're going to give Memphis a free play here. They jumped off sides on third down and 15. And to make matters worse, a coverage bust. As Magnifico, the tight end, still on his feet, rumbling into UCF territory. A third and 15 conversion. A gain of 41.
15.
He's declined. The result of the play is a first down.
And how about the balance to stay on his feet as he never hit the ground? Fell on top of Neville Clark.
And how about the job of Brady White making the biggest play of this game? By far, maybe the biggest play of this season with where this third quarter was looking for the quarterback.
Play action. That ball batted down as Kyle Gibson got in the passing lane.
Yeah, this may have been picked off if this ball does not get tipped here at the line of scrimmage, as Brady's wide receiver was stumbling as well. Man, this has been a game of inches, a game of calls, a game of tug of war at the line of scrimmage. Exactly the kind of game you wanted on this Saturday night.
Tony Pollard wants the football and finds a cutback lane. This looks like the first half for Memphis as Pollard dragging Knights inside the 25-yard line.
Now here's going to be some of the danger with this adjustment. You are going to have now eight Knights around the line of scrimmage within 5 yards. And if you can make that one miss, there are going to be explosive plays. I mean, you just have to sell out. Watch these safeties. That's been some of the adjustment here in the second half as you are getting around the line of scrimmage. You have to do it, but there still can be big plays if you get people blocked.
Patrick Taylor. Strong run on first down. Close to the 16-yard line. Titus Davis made the stop.
How big was third and 15?
Changed the game.
I mean, your odds in this building of third and 15 down in that end zone with the amount of noise in this third quarter, and the number is pretty clear, the best third quarter team in college football. Infinitely small. And yet Brady beat him with the cadence, kept the play alive, and the huge conversion that's changed a little of the momentum.
Darrell Henderson shaken up earlier on this drive. You saw him on the sideline. No big deal. You got Patrick Taylor, who's now over 100 yards as well. He gets the call again. He finds room again. First down again to the 10-yard line. And with the nose of the football touching the 10-yard line, it is first and goal.
That was a really nice job by the backup right tackle, Scotty Dill, who is in the game. His pops played 10 years in the league, had to love that block. He is in for the injured Joseph as well, and he set the table on that one.
Taylor. Gang tackled at the 6. Nate Evans led the charge for UCF. Darrell Henderson back in for the Tigers on second down and goal. And he's in the backfield with Pollard. Henderson with blockers in front spins to the 2-yard line.
There are just some massive collisions with these safeties, and that time it was Kyle Gibson that had to come up in that one-on-one situation. I might be thinking very seriously about 2 more downs and just continuing to run the ball and make that statement.
Third down and goal. Play action. White across his body. Leaping attempt made by Coxey. And he couldn't haul it in. Now what do you do? It is fourth down and goal at the 2-yard line. And it looks like Mike Norvell's going to take some points. He's going to send his group out for a chip shot field goal after Coxey had that opportunity at a touchdown. And he's going to try and stretch the lead to 6 with Riley Patterson. Patterson puts it through. A 6-point lead in the championship game for Memphis.
At Papa John's, we want you to know that from our 450-degree oven to box to you, it's our policy that your pizza is never touched once it comes out of the oven. And we're taking extra steps like no-contact delivery to ensure it.
You're watching Knights Rewatch, presented by Dex Imaging. Do business better. Now back to UCF football.
If UCF can come from behind and win the American Championship game, they would play once again in a New Year's Six bowl game. And once again, Brock, would have at least that argument to be made about maybe an expansion of the playoff. Why are we not given a chance to get into the top four as an undefeated team? But they still have to overcome Memphis these next 17 minutes to get it done.
I think we all wonder, could they overcome the loss of Mackenzie Milton emotionally, physically, at the quarterback position? And right now, Mackenzie, who I know is watching this game with his dad, has got to be so immensely proud of the fight in these Knights.
Killens cut down at the 24-yard line.
This UCF team that had to battle injuries, this UCF team that had to battle adversity up in Memphis, down two scores. A group that has gone through some of those tough battles, an Alabama team that has not, that right now going to be one of the biggest shockers in all of college football this season.
Jet sweep to Anderson. He's got five.
It's amazing how loud this place is. What great fans, how loud it is when their defense is out there and you can hear a pin drop at times. And they're on offense tonight. Kudos to this fan base.
Bray. About a yard shy of a first down. It'll be third down and one for UCF. And you're right, nothing tells you that a crowd is more educated than when they know when to be loud and know when to be quiet. They're going to get loud now as Mack pushes the pile for a first down.
Was that Corso in the night suit or was that their mascot, you know?
Lateral move.
Okay.
Play action. Quick throw to the sideline to Marlon Williams. And Mack has a 7-yard completion.
And they've got this crew on their heels. You can just feel it. You felt it with McKenzie for 24 games. That defense just did not have answers. You put numbers in the box, and we're going to throw it. You keep safeties deep, you're going to run it.
It'll be third down. McCray hit by J.J. Russell right at the line of scrimmage. Can Memphis get a stop? Quarterback draw. Mack gets a block, but he is upended before he can get to the line to gain. Great play by the corner, T.J. Carter, to get to the ankles of DJ Mack. Now fourth down and a yard, and UCF is leaving their offense on the field. They don't have to run another play before the end of the quarter. They can take the time to make this decision, and they will. Can you imagine a potentially more dramatic way to start off the fourth quarter of a championship game than fourth and one on UCF's own side of the 50?
Guess what I just did? I got a night pass.
Night pass?
Yeah, ePass is now offering night fans UCF branded toll stickers. See for yourself. My windshield now sports night black and gold.
They'll certainly see you coming. But does night pass work on all toll roads in Florida?
Yes, it's accepted on all toll roads in Florida, Georgia, and North Carolina.
Go night pass.
It's how nights travel.
Score big and save more with night pass. Go to getnightpass.com. Getnightpass.com. Hey, night fans. What's on your windshield?
Welcome back to the American Athletic Conference Football Championship game on ABC, presented by Jared. It's part of Dr. Pepper Championship Week. Start the fourth quarter with fourth down and one. That was just confirmed.
Yeah, a little confusion here because of where the marker is. The official line at the top is at the 49. Okay, that is the line. Unfortunately, the marker down here is at the 48. So there was confusion, I think, in this building. The fans reacted but the official line to gain at the top of the screen had it exactly right at the 49. And this spot is right for the fourth and one.
And how about this decision to go for it for UCF on their side of the 50 to start the fourth quarter? Greg McCray gets outside. Inside the 20. Down to the 2-yard line. TJ Carter saved a touchdown. Again, UCF wanted to go quickly, but there is an injured Tiger back at midfield behind the play. That's Tyrez Lindsey, the strong safety.
A tremendous job on the right side of that line. It all started with Jake Brown, the first team all-conference player that sets the edge. You've seen it the other side. It's been power football in the American Conference tonight, baby. It's been a line of scrimmage game. And that time, the three first-team all-conference members, it was Brown, it was Schneider, it was Johnson, that I guarantee you at half to, at the end of that third quarter, had a little talking to with the head coach, saying, you trust us. We got you here. We're going to get you this first down and even more with yet another explosive play in this one.
UCF team that gave the ball away three times in the first half. Trailed a couple of times by 17. Knocking on the door to take the lead. Quarterback run. Breaking a tackle is DJ Mack. He's got another touchdown.
Strong. He's real strong. That is a one-on-one with the middle linebacker, Curtis Akins, right there in the hole. The biggest hitter, one of the strongest defenders for Memphis, and he can't bring the confident quarterback down.
UCF leads. Filling in for Mackenzie Milton, the redshirt freshman. Gives them the lead.
Addition Financial can't help Olivia's mom make a perfect unicorn cake. But for smart financing, money management, and college savings, count us in.
The very appropriately named Hope Mack, the mom of DJ Mack, who is watching her little boy run like a man and give UCF the lead as he has a couple of second-half rushing touchdowns. As we take a look at our Pacific Life game summary, what a turnaround Darryl Mack has engineered here in the third quarter for the Knights.
Yep. And you can feel it, and this building feels it, even when they were down. And now the booth is shaking, Bob.
It's the bounce house for a reason. Pollard from inside the five.
So, guys, Darryl Henderson looks like he may be making his way back out onto the field, at least joining this offensive huddle. He did have a heating pad on his right calf and right shin. So we'll see if he is able to go, if he's 100%.
It looks like Antoine Collier, a backup defensive back, injured for UCF. Darryl Henderson went over 200 yards rushing in the first half. So if Memphis can get their workhorse healthy and on the field, that could change this game in the fourth quarter.
At Chick-fil-A, we may be about the little things, but for us, community is a big thing. It brings out the best in us all, even in times as uncertain as these. While we can't have the pleasure of serving you in our dining areas, we're still here for you
With delivery, drive-through, and mobile order where possible, in compliance with state and local regulations. Order through the Chick-fil-A app or our delivery partners, and we'll see you soon. In the meantime, let's all take good care of each other.
Mackenzie Milton, I'm sure he can feel the support that has rallied around him here at UCF all week. And on game day, Ohana meets family in Hawaii, and that has become a hashtag combined with his number. And boy, has his team responded, down by 17 two different times in this game. UCF has come back to take the lead. Now, how will Memphis respond? Behind the line, down goes Darryl Henderson again. Tristan Hill, another tackle for loss.
He has just been an absolute monster. He has been the unblockable guy. But ultimately, Randy Shannon, that defensive staff at halftime said, who's it going to be? Tristan, he had two tackles for loss in that first half. Can you do it again? Can you back it up? Can you be the one that is going to create the penetration and stop these home run hitters from swinging?
Brady White, nice hookup to Magnifico, the tight end, and he runs for a first down. Antoine Collier, by the way, who was injured on kickoff return, took a headshot as he was the player that got in and made the stop on Tony Pollard. And he walked off the field very slowly, and they're checking him out. Jump ball. Coming back to make the catch is Devontae Coxey. Josh Heupel and the sideline for UCF looking for a push-off on Brandon Moore.
It's a pretty good response here from Mike Norville. I love the play calls back to back. You're letting them both fight just a little bit. Now you got to let them play. Let them play.
That's Brock Heward. I'm Bob Wischusen. Allison Williams with us here as well. Pollard. Takes a hit and gets out to about the 49-yard line. Back to Matt Barry. Championship Saturday, any fun? Brady White out of the pocket. He'll tuck it under and end up about 3 yards shy of a first down. There's Tristan Hill again.
He's just playing the game of his season. You know, second team all-conference last year. And he's just not been the same kind of factor this season, but this is all want to. If he does not do this, this is another first down. Instead, well, it's going to be a third and three, and this stadium once again is going to come roaring.
Uh-oh. There's your impact player, as it looks like he might be cramping up after that sprint to the sideline. So he sold out to make sure that Brady White couldn't scramble for a first down. And it looks like they need to stretch him back out.
Now there's no gas left in the tank. That's exactly what that is. I'll tell you, there's something about Alabama, Georgia, that those two teams just match up wise, coaching wise, familiarity of scheme, and they know each other so well that sets up that fight. And just like this one, these two have played each other four times. There's no secrets in personnel. There's no secrets in game plan. There's adjustments, and there's a whole lot of effort, but just two great battles here on championship weekend.
Well, they're still trying to stretch that right leg out, as you can only explain why he went down is maybe that right leg cramped up, or he just needed a rest. But a big third down where you would want Tristan Hill on the field.
I'll tell you,
and he's going to have to come off.
I'll tell you one other thing I've been really impressed with tonight are both Heupel and Norville as play callers. Mike Norville is head coach, play caller. Josh Heupel is head coach, play caller. And you see it at the NFL level with Sean McVay. You see it, obviously, with the Saints as well. Sean Payton there. And when that is your gift, right, when you played the position, when you were coordinator at Oklahoma, Mike Norville, he's been a coordinator all the way up as well at ASU. This is your gift, and these two are excellent at it. Punch, counter punch, adjust, take what the defense gives you, assert yourself, but fun little back and forth between two excellent play callers as well.
Big third down after the injury timeout. Screen, Machane Slade, first down, his first reception. And that is a big one.
What a great call. Again, great call. You've seen it. You've seen Wildcat, but you're not just stuck in one thing. You know, this possession in particular, moving the pocket, play pass, get the ball out of your hands. Just do not let that defense get comfortable with just one look.
Anderson, nothing there. Where was this in the first half? Nate Evans makes the stop. This is a young man that ran for 200 yards plus in the first half. They were gashed for a massive number of rushing yards in the first 30 minutes, and UCF's defense has been a totally different group in the second half.
Penetration up front, linebackers reading their keys, being out in front of it, not on their heels, absorbing the blocks 3 yards downfield.
Out of the pocket once again is White. Once again, he'll take off and run. Tiptoes the sideline for a Memphis first down.
Big time. Big time, Brady White. These are the moments that you live for. This is why you transferred after an injury-riddled season there at ASU. That you got there in the spring and won this team over. Couldn't make the plays in the second half of the first matchup between these two. But he has played a brilliant second half, managing, owning the football, and owning these third down conversions.
Now White again splits out wide, setting up the Wildcat with Patrick Taylor. And Taylor will run power right up the middle. And that's good for 5 yards. Tenth play of the drive. White contested, broken up. Tony Pollard, the intended receiver, and Rashard Causey read it, jumped the route, knocked it away, and sets up third down and 5.
Just a little bit of hesitation here, and an excellent job by Causey. He is all over. Look at his eyes in the backfield there. And nearly the game-changing turnover that UCF has gotten all season long, and Brady got away with one.
Four-man rush. Brady White out of the pocket again. Fires one across his body. That's broken up at the 10-yard line. Novell Clark, another pass defensed. Coxie, the intended receiver. And now you're in that gray area, fourth down and 5. And it looks like they're going to send Riley Patterson out to try and take the lead.
And give A.J. Wooten some credit there as well. Beautifully played. The arms off the back right there. That's how you do it, young corners. Don't go through the body. Don't grab and reach. And what a big opportunity here for Riley after a critical miss in this game a season ago.
He missed a couple last season, including a 51-yarder. That would have avoided overtime. This one. Just wide right from 45. And UCF maintains the lead. Just that close to Memphis going back on top.
Undeniable.
It's the 14th annual Dr. Pepper ACC Championship Game coming up next between Pitt and Clemson. Hopefully, Chris and Herbie will have a game anywhere near as good as our game has been, 8 Eastern here on ABC and the ESPN app. So you can watch anywhere. What chance is there that Pitt puts a scare into Clemson?
Well, they better run it, and they better run it for 4 quarters. But unfortunately, their strength in that matchup is exactly the strength of Clemson as well.
Patient run here from McCray. Gets outside. McCray down the sideline. Hit from behind. But not before he crosses the 50. J.J. Russell brings him down, but it's a 26-yard gain. And how patient was Greg McCray behind the developing blockers? Yep. Jet sweep. Anderson. This time, nothing there, lost a yard.
Memphis defensive coach is telling their guys, you just need to get a takeaway. They want to bust out that turnover rope. They're telling them if we can just get the ball back, and also adding, if we want to be champions, champs get back off the mat, and they keep swinging. Mike Norvell coming over and telling his guys, we're going to go out there and we're going to finish this thing.
Let's see if they do. Mack. Inside the 40-yard line, out of bounds at about the 38 is the Ole Miss transfer, Trey Nixon. Third down and 3. Can Memphis get a stop? That'll be a false start. That's a big penalty. Now it'll be third down and 8.
Snap infraction, offense, number 72. It's a 5-yard penalty, third down.
Penalty goes against Ice. Mark it back to the 43, third down and 8.
Third down and 8. Is this 4 down territory for UCF? Maybe depending on what happens with this play. Play clock under 5. Matt gets the snap off. It's Killens. First down and then some.
Well, you wanted it. And on the sidelines there, as Allison was just reporting, here you go. This is about your identity. Who wants it a little bit more? And look at UCF continue to come right back to the line again.
They go quickly. Taking a shot towards the back of the end zone with a flag down is Mack. Well overthrows Trey Nixon. But Memphis tried to sub. And UCF kept their 11 on the field. So the officials, they put the ball ready for play.
Substitution infraction, 12 men on the field for the defense. It's a 5-yard penalty, first down.
It wasn't even close. I mean, that just simply was not even close for Memphis there defensively. I don't know why Mike Norvell thought he could sub. UCF did not. They caught them clean. And this is all about identity. That third down and 8, all about identity. That UCF feels like up front they are bigger, they are stronger, they are tougher. And I love that call from Josh Heupel as well. And all those first-team all-conference players putting on Memphis.
Mack pulls it back. He'll take off and run again. And that's a first down into the red zone to the 17-yard line. Curtis Aiken spun him down.
And I'll say this, too. This is nearly 600 yards of offense now for UCF. And if you thought this was just a one-man show, you thought wrong.
Killens, jump cut to the left. Close to the 12-yard line. They'll mark him out. Looks like right at the 12. Sanchez Blake bumped him out. That's a gain of 5. Killens up the middle. First and goal at the 2.
They're just moving. I mean, there is no answer. Look at it. He doesn't care that he gets hit.
And we've got an injured Tiger that the crowd is going to react as if this is a slowdown technique. With Memphis on their heels, he's got a flat tire. We got a guy out there without a shoe. J.J. Russell is the injured Memphis player.
you know, that first half, we talked about the Memphis crew up front, just this line of scrimmage in this surge. And I just cannot give enough credit to these guys. Look at the movement. Look at them down the field right here. Look at this double team. These are two all-conference players. You want it when the game is on the line? All you've got to do is get to a body on a body and let these guys behind you who have such incredible courage at 170 plus pounds running right between those tackles and wearing Memphis out. 617 yards, 80 plays, down 17, and it doesn't matter. When you have championship DNA that has been built for 2 years, you salivate over these moments to finish.
First and goal at the two. Mack looking for another rushing touchdown. He's at the goal line. He's got it. Still only a one possession game, even if Wright makes the point after, but 6:37 to go. And now UCF has their largest lead.
Pacifico is brewed for those who follow their own path. That's living life anchors up.
An 8-point lead for UCF with 6.5 minutes to go. Bob Beschus and Brock Ewart, Allison Williams at the American Championship game as we take a look at tonight's PlayStation Player Index. Darrell Henderson, talk about a tale of two halves. This pretty much symbolizes the game.
And it symbolized what happened up in Memphis, Tennessee, where the Tigers were running all over UCF in the first half and had a two-possession lead in that game as well in their own building, and they just could not finish. And it's been the case 12 of the last 13 times, and more importantly, the last three times over the last 2 years in this battle royale.
Tony Pollard has 6 career kickoff return touchdowns. His next would tie an NCAA record. Except here it's Henderson. He's going to throw one back to Pollard. The trick play is at least going to give Memphis pretty good field position. How about that setup?
That's really well done, and that's hard to do, to not be a forward pass because of momentum. Typically, when you've seen that done, you know, those guys get so excited that you're going to see very well to get that first forward momentum and make sure it is thrown laterally there. That's perfectly executed.
Does that give Memphis a little bit of momentum? And what is still a one possession game, they've got all three of their timeouts, so they could conceivably get the ball twice in the last 6.5 minutes. Here we go. Incomplete. White was looking for Patrick Taylor. Good coverage from Nate Evans.
There's just got to be a double move at some point here for Mike Norvell. This group is just playing so downhill defensively that at some juncture in 6 minutes, you've got to use that aggressiveness against them.
It's a wildcat snap instead. Taylor for 2 yards, third down and 8.
Those are the safeties. Those are the players that are just down there. It's said enough to give credit to Randy Shannon and his defensive staff that have made these kind of adjustments all year long.
White under pressure. He's going to go down. Titus Davis collapses the pocket. And here comes the punt group. No choice for Memphis with their timeouts to do anything here but kick it away.
Yep.
It's fourth and about 15. Good punt from Williams. Anderson, an immediate fair catch inside the 20-yard line.
You've not seen this kind of pressure. And I think the left tackle, Travion Tate, one of the best, but Titus gets to him. Titus Davis beats him off the jump. And that's just a perfect picture of these guys that are just playing a tick ahead. The 40-some thousand in here that are going nuts, that are creating chaos and havoc at the line of scrimmage. And these Knights are feeding right off that energy.
And you can tune into the ESPN app for our post-game trophy ceremony immediately following the America Championship game. And will it be back-to-back years handed to UCF with a win over Memphis? Or can the Tigers get a stop, use their timeouts if necessary, and get the ball back to their offense with one more chance? Greg McCray. Just across the 20-yard line, stood up by Jonathan Wilson. Now, Brock, I know these tempo teams only practice tempo. There is no reason for UCF to do anything other than take the clock down as far as they possibly can before they snap it again.
Shorten this game.
And they're at the line, set to go with 20 on the play clock. And they snap it with 17 on the play clock. Mack, he's going to go deep. For Snelson, he's got it. Why wait? They never take their foot off the gas pedal.
Nope. What a big time throw. What a big time second half here from Darryl Mack. What a response. Bob, it is one thing to watch this team from afar, and I know Kirk and Chris felt it when they were in here just a couple weeks ago as well. It is quite another to experience the resilience, and Mike Norvell knows well, far too well, the kind of champion he is competing against.
Here's McCray. That time they did take the clock down as far as they could, and now the timeouts will start to be used by Mike Norvell as Memphis will call their first with 3:51 to go. SportsCenter with Kenny Mayne and Michael Eaves tonight after the Mountain West Championship game. They'll have all the highlights, post-game coverage, and reactions from Championship Saturday. Plus, which teams have played their way into the college football playoff. SportsCenter after Fresno, Boise State on ESPN and the ESPN app later on tonight.
Well, I'll say this. In that Alabama game, and Tua looks like, again, he is banged up and injured. And much like they've had to respond to some of the best player in college football being out, and Mike Norvell knew that Mackenzie Milton was out, and Memphis, like so many around college football, sending their Will Wishes, sending the football, sending a response to Mackenzie, who is watching this game. And I'll raise my hand as one of many that wondered, what was this team going to be like without their William Wallace? Well, I'll tell you what, they have answered it. And Darryl Mack has answered it. And the rest of this crew has answered it with well over 600 yards of offense and 346 tonight by Mack.
Killens has a crease and a first down. A backbreaker for Memphis defensively.
Guys, a lot of what Brock is talking about is exactly what Coach Heupel told us yesterday. He said championship teams aren't always the ones with the most talent, but there is something special about a group that can win. And this group has it. There's a brotherhood. There's a competitive spirit, an ability to handle adversity. He said these kids are special. You don't do what they've done unless you have an extremely special group. We're seeing it again tonight.
Killens tries the left side. And he gets down inside the 15-yard line, and now another timeout will be called by Memphis.
You know, and I've said to you before, Bob, give me an offense and give me a team identified by their offensive line. you just can't do it better than this. These are two first-team conference players, and you just don't do it better than that. I mean, that is absolutely textbook. There is nobody in college football that can run this play better than this action right here. That counter football, first-team all-conference, first-team all-conference, first-team all-conference, second-team all-conference. For those committee members that sat in that room last week and said, you know what? Yeah, I know they're 11-0. I know they've got some good players, some really good backs. You know what they've got? They've got one of the most phenomenal offensive lines that have played together for 3 years. They have got a heart of a champion that does not matter what they're up against. And when they lose, their wizard, their warrior, what do those big guys do tonight? What do they do against a really stout Memphis front seven? They took this game over, and they carried a redshirt freshman who also really came to life, and I know wanted to so badly for his friend who's watching at home.
And they piled up 687 yards of offense and are in position to put this game away. Memphis has to get a stop. Killens gets to the 10. It's another first down. He has stood up at about the 6 yard line. But now Memphis only has one timeout left. And this will take us inside of 3 minutes to go with a fresh set of downs for UCF.
And if Mike Norvell was more proud of his team a week ago against Houston than he's ever been, I guarantee you Josh Heupel has won all 11 this season and won a pretty big one up in Memphis in the rainstorm. But this is going to be the most meaningful for him, bar none. Bar none. The country question, the committee question, how good is this team? Are they just about one guy in committee? They are not.
Play clock winding down, and Heupel wants his team to line up and snap the ball. Killens. Turn back just inside the 5 yard line. And now Mike Norvell has no choice but to spend his final timeout with 2:33 to go and hope for a miracle.
You know, it was a couple years ago. Remember Ohio State lost Braxton Miller. Oh man, the other guys go down. JT Barrett set all the records, more touchdowns than anybody in the Big Ten. And then what happened? Oh, that guy Cardale Jones came in. Wow, they can't win with a second or third string quarterback. Are you sure? Are you sure? Did you think it was just about JT Barrett, or was it about that whole championship fiber of that place and that culture? And they answered the bell. And I think tonight in this building, this program has as well. And they're a couple minutes away. No timeouts left for Memphis. If they finish this deal here, I guarantee you, I saw him in the Peach Bowl. I called that game, you know. Allison was there as well. Auburn, NFL guys galore, NFL running back, NFL tackle, NFL linebackers. Oh, surely UCF couldn't match up with them, right, in the Peach Bowl? Well, ask Gus Malzahn, Kevin Steele, about that game.
And what they have shown tonight is they are far from a one-man band. Darryl Mack has thrown for more yards in this game than Mackenzie Milton has thrown for in any game this season. And he's going to try to run for another score here. And he's got it. Four rushing touchdowns for DJ Mack.
There's going to be some kind of party in Orlando tonight. And Teresa Milton and Hope Mack, quarterback moms, I know them. It's a hard spot to be sometimes. And you can see both of them so thankful for this opportunity, for this building, for McKenzie at home with his dad, and for mom cheering on her boy who fumbled it three times in that first half. And could have very easily gone into a shell, and boy, did he not.
5 second half possessions for UCF, 5 touchdowns. And 4 of those 5 touchdowns scored by DJ Mack.
Yeah, I can imagine right now, there's people all over college football watching this game. It's kind of the cool thing about championship weekend, right? There's just a few games on. And Scott Frost and his staff, I bet you in Lincoln, Nebraska right now, are watching this game wherever they are, if they're out recruiting or they're together going, and these kids are so stinking tough, so proud of what they did a year ago, and then to build on it once again. and for McKenzie and his dad in their living room in their home right now, back after three surgeries this week, after the catastrophic injury, after all of college football, McKenzie, that is so rooting for you, and you will come back again. I really believe that. And then for the naysayers that were really hoping that this would end for UCF, that they just were a one-trick show, that they just really weren't that good. I'm sorry, naysayers, they are that good. And they're 2 minutes and 29 seconds from winning their 25th in a row and doing everything that they can possibly do on their schedule to prove it.
That kick out of bounds, so it will come out to the 35-yard line. And UCF this season has lived off of takeaways. They have lived off of dominating the plus-minus ratio. Well, look at today. FBS teams coming into today's game, if they were minus three or worse, 14 and 114. And what is UCF today? Minus three. And they've got a two-score lead with 2.5 minutes to go. Yeah. In a championship game against arguably the second best team in your league.
And I'm going to tell all of you right there in that picture, you had something to do with this tonight. Your energy never ceased. And you never doubted in this building, and your defense fed off of it.
Brady White, incomplete through the hands of Patrick Taylor. They're unpacking the championship t-shirts. 2:24 to go and no timeouts for Memphis. So they need a score and they need an onside kick. Play clock under 10. And the Tigers trying to get lined up. White forces one to the sideline, and that is good to Sean Dykes for about a 4-yard gain. They'll give him forward progress to the 41 for a 6-yard gain, but it's still third down at 4. And Memphis has got to go. They need a sense of urgency here with 2 minutes to go. Brady White out of the pocket. He's going to run for a first down. That'll stop the clock with 1:49 remaining.
He's sure done an excellent job of that here in the second half, hasn't he? Of just continuing to buy some time. He's put together a really nice season. He had an enormous third and 15 to keep this game close, to stem some of the tide here in the second half. He's still got a minute 49 to do some damage. I'm sure a sense of urgency.
Seam shot is there for Dykes. That's a first down to the UCF 34-yard line. The clock stops just for a moment. 19-yard gain. Can they get one in the end zone and still have enough time on the clock to at least have the hope of an onside kick? Avoiding a sack is White, and throws it away.
Smart. You can see the reinforcements coming on the field. Four fresh nights for Mike Norvell. And this offense that is built to run first. You saw in that first half, they had the game. They had it stylistically the way they needed to. They were up 17 in that second half. And unfortunately now it is a one-dimensional mode.
White, wide open, making a first down catch at about the 19-yard line. Here's Machane Slade.
Machane Slade moves the sticks. First and 10 Tigers from the 19.
White trying to extend the play, and does. Throws it away again. 1:09 to go.
Yeah, he was looking for Coxey there. That is his touchdown maker. And Heupel doesn't like it. I think he thought there was a takedown holding call that he was not going to get. And the inability to really get Coxie going down the field, their big play threat. Heupel and his crew credit. They know it. They pay an awful lot of attention to him.
UCF brings a blitz. White steps up, and he gets tripped up and goes down. Back at the 25-yard line. Causey gets the sack. And now that will cost Memphis valuable seconds.
And I like that call. What a great call from Randy Shannon here. No longer just rushing for a perfect nickel blitz. And then one-on-one situation, beating Pollard for the sack was Causey. Enormous.
All the time coming off the clock before third down. White, long throw to the sideline, and it will come down to fourth down with 40 seconds to go. And not only is it fourth down, realistically, if you look at how much time is left on the clock,
yep,
and you need two scores, this can't even be just an attempt for a first down. This ball needs to go to the end zone, because you need enough time for a score, end an onside kick, end another possession. White, he does throw it to the end zone, and it's intercepted. The exclamation point for Richie Grant and UCF. Okay. Formation for the Knights. Two different times, down by 17. That will do it. For the second consecutive year, the American Championship game is won by the Knights over Memphis.
Hearts of a champion. Proved it today. Do the right thing, committee. They've earned it. They're better than the 7th team in this country, period.
Is that Mackenzie Milton being FaceTimed in by mom, getting to experience with mom the scene here at the bounce house? That's amazing. Let's go down to Allison.
Coach Heupel, your team was down by 17 at the half without your star quarterback, Mackenzie Milton. How did they battle back to become conference champions?
Man, this group handles adversity better than any group I've ever been around. You look at what they did this past season, what they did this week. This is a team of champions, man. They deserve everything they've earned it, man.
What changed in the second half? The first half, you struggled to stop the run, the fumbles. What changed?
You play assignment sound. We had great communication, all three levels defensively. Defeated blocks, went and made tackles. Offensively, we took care of the football, and that's how you go light it up.
So you're conference champions. You know you will play in a New Year's Six bowl game, but beyond that, the rest is out of your control. What do you say to the college football playoff committee members?
This team, you look at what this program's done for two straight years. This team's got a heart of a champion. They deserve the opportunity to go prove it on the field.
Josh, thank you.
Appreciate it.
Miami Hurricanes in the early 2000s, the 2012-2014 Florida State Seminoles, and Alabama from 2015 to 2016, and UCF. Those are the only four programs that have had, at least in this century, a winning streak of 25 or more games. Yep. That's the company UCF is keeping.
Can I just say thank you, college football? I'll sign up for championship weekend anytime.
For Allison Williams and Brock Ewart, I'm Bob Wischusen. Tune to the ESPN app for our post-game championship trophy presentation. Good night from Orlando. Back to Kevin Negandhi.
Thank you for watching Knights Rewatch, presented by Dex Imaging, a proud sponsor of UCF Athletics. Dex Imaging is the nation's largest independent provider of office technology with a local touch. Dex Imaging, do business better. Also presented in part by Tico People's Gas, delivering natural gas that helps you save energy. Visit peoplesgas.com. And by Pacifico Beer, reminding everyone that if you've made it here, you're already living life anchors up. Discover Pacifico responsibly.